What's up, everybody? Welcome to DWX, where we tackle data science topics for scientists. So, have you ever thought to yourself, hey, I'd like to make an app. I have a great idea. I want to share that idea, but I have no idea how to make an app. Or maybe you're on the other side and you're like, I have this cool idea, not for an app, but this complicated idea, and I want to share that idea. Maybe I want to teach some students something. I want them to interact with the data instead of me just sitting there and lecturing at them. Maybe I want them to test out some ideas with like rotation of a fluid. How can I do that? Well, I was sitting at home one day and I got this email from the folks at Plotly. And the cool email that they sent was, hey, we got this new thing where you can create a GUI or an application just with Python. I thought, intriguing. Let's try it out. So I immediately jumped on board, installed it, and started playing around with it one night. And I found it really easy and really intuitive. And the nice part is I didn't have to be some kind of expert with front-end development and to get the kind of interactivity that most applications would need. So I think it's helpful to see a few examples to get an idea for exactly what Plotly Dash can do. So first we'll look at a few examples. Then we're going to look at the basic outline about how to structure your code or what the basic components are of a Dash application. And then in later videos, we'll go ahead and build a few. So let's jump into some of these examples. First one here, you can see some interactivity happening on the screen here. This is a pretty cool one if you just let it play out. It's an image of a methodology support vector machine, and this is specifically used for classifying, for classification. And you can see there's a little mouse here pushing different buttons and moving sliders along, so you can see that the graphs are dynamic and they're responding to that clickability. Really nice feature. I like this one, t-SNE, interactive t-SNE. Here's their t-SNE Explorer. And that was just on the Dash gallery, so you can go check out any of these and play around with them too. Let's click on a data set, select data set. We will click on that drop-down menu, select MNIST digits. This is this vast data set of images of handwritten digits. And the whole idea behind it is to have a really well-groomed data set of handwritten digit images to see if you can get your software, your machine learning algorithm to classify the digits correctly based off of just the pixels in the image. So this is like kind of your hello world example of machine learning. All right, they're using a methodology called t-SNE, and what this is basically trying to do is take every single one of those pixels in an image. So that's well over, what is it, like 700, I think it's 700 pixels. In this case, it might be a lot less, but it's a lot of pixels. Each pixel you could think of as a variable or a dimension. So what you're trying to do is distill the information in all of those pixels down to three dimensions. So imagine if you had three pixels, in conceptually speaking, to represent the entirety of the image. And can you separate now the certain digits based off of just those three dimensions? So that's what t-SNE is doing. It's a way to visualize that separation. And you can see each color here represents a digit. If I click on one of these, right, even just highlighting. So this is a Plotly feature. Just scrolling over here, you see it tells you what the coordinates are. And it also tells you the digit. If I click on this, see it shows up. Here's that particular image that was classified as a 1. That's most definitely a 1. Awesome. The neat part is I can interact with this graph. That's just the Plotly feature. What Dash offers is now not just do I have these drop downs, but I can have that graph respond in real time. So this is a particular parameter called perplexity. And if I click on 50, for example, you see the image change on the right to reflect the fact that the perplexity parameter changed. And you can see that here. So that's a very nice feature. You know, you can click on any one of these, you know, the PCA. Principal component analysis, and you can see it changing here. And the nice part is because this is through the browser, you get all the functionality with your basic HTML and web page layout, and you get to visualize it through the browser. Very nice, very cool. So I took a stab at making an app for myself. It was a while back. Well, I guess this one wasn't a while back. This is something I just made recently for fun to test out Markdown language. So Markdown is this really handy, we'll call it a shorthand for writing text with with more detail. So for example, if I wanted to write a header, it would just be a hashtag or pound sign. And you would type it like this. This is means header 1, h1. And you type in like, this is a cool title. Quote. I don't know. What's a good quote? Catch me outside. That's not a cool quote, though. I don't know. Whatever you want. Let's do this all weird. Tell me what you want. And that was a quote by me just now. But also, right? So you can do your basic markdown language. And you can see it's responding in real time on the side there. Right, really cool. Let's do a little block code example too. Why not? Import something special. So your basic interactivity, really cool for me testing stuff out in Markdown. I did another slightly more complicated example. Again, personal use. Oops. And you can see I'm just punching in URLs in the browser, and that's the cool part here is I'm running these. These are all locally run. So this is not on the web somewhere. This is something that I made for personal use, and I'm running these applications through my browser. So I could have this up at any time, as long as I'm running the application in the background. And this is a simple weather app. It tells you the current weather in Durham, North Carolina. Apparently it's 34 degrees right now, cloudy skies, and 34 degrees. And you can type in whatever zip code you want here. Let's give Ann Arbor a go. Is it 4 or 5? I think it's 4. Click on that, and you can see the weather changed. The application responded in real time. This application is pulling from the Yahoo Weather API, and it's also using some Google Maps API as well. But you can see you can be as complicated or as simple as you want with these applications. But the functionality is there for you to create this with Dash. And it's all, like I said, done through the browser, which I think is much nicer than having a GUI interface that requires some other machine-specific kind of code. So here you go, and nice part again is that you have access to all the Plotly figures. So all that Plotly figures you see on the Plotly website, you have access to all of those within your application as well. And you can see here, here's one of those applications. You can scroll and see the temperature for the next 10 days. All right, so those were a few examples, but let's jump in to the structure and maybe the components of a Dash application so we can get a little bit more tangible. Now let's move over to a text editor. Little blank one here. All right. There are three basic components to your application. Two of which is where you take some thought into what you wish to develop. So let's go into that. First, you're going to import Dash. All right. Next thing you do is create an app instance. So this would be dash.dash, and you'll just name it whatever the name of the file is. So first step here was create a Dash instance. In other words, say I want an app. And I'm using the words app and GUI interchangeably here. They're the same thing to me, just apps can be deployed through your browser. GUIs, I think, are maybe more specific to your computer. Maybe there isn't a distinction. I don't know. Correct me in the comments. Let me know. I always thought they were different. And the second part. So the first step, right, say I want to make an app. Second part is define the app layout. So all the stuff you want on your web page. I want a button here. I want a drop-down menu here. I want to put a header here. This is what is the app layout. And you would define that, say, app layout, and you'd set this equal to a bunch of stuff. We'll leave it blank for now. This is where a lot of the meat is going to be. Put it in there. And then the last thing, and this is the cool part that Dash offers, is interactivity, otherwise known as callbacks. And these would look like something like app.callback, like that, and then you define some functionality here. Functionality. And what you would put in here is to say, I want this button, or rather, when I press this button, I want this thing to happen. You know, so this is where you'd allow the opponent components to interact. So you'd say, when I push a button, this is supposed to happen. When I click a drop-down menu, it has this in it. And when I click on it and select something from the drop-down, this I want, you know, some other text or an image to render on the screen. So this is where you specify all that cool interactivity we saw. And of course, at the bottom here, you're going to be, you know, running your, you know, this is like if, you know, what is it, name, whatever, main, that the basic Python thing. Down here, you're going to have like app run server. And when you're doing stuff locally, you can just put it in debug mode so you can see what's going on. So those are your basic components of an application. Create a dash instance, define the app layout, and then define the interactivity between the stuff in your layout. That's it. Really simple and easy so far. All right. As far as those things in the layout go, how do I go about, you know, defining that I want a drop-down menu? Well, of course, people at Dash have already thought about it. In particular, they have things like core components called, I'm gonna probably screw this up. I think it's core components like that. Let me just go to the website. So they have core components, which are those like drop downs and whatnot. Let's not go to the gallery. Let's go here. Oops. Take away the word gallery. And if you scroll down on the Dash Plotly website here, you see they have this tutorial series. Go through that tutorial. Really helpful. After you go through that tutorial, you'll find yourself having a ton of ideas of things you want to do, probably. And then it's helpful to go to the core components. So if you go to the core components, this is where they tell you, here's this thing they call a dropdown. If you were to copy and paste this and put it in your layout, you would see exactly this kind of dropdown in your layout. Actually, why not? Let's give it a try. I'm feeling ambitious. Put that in the dropdown there. Right here. Oh, crud. Stupid Ubuntu with their highlighting. Let's try it again. Copy paste. Throw that in here. Dadgummit. Well, not copy and pasting, but we'll write it ourselves. DCC, drop down, and you can just put it there. So the point is that you can put a drop down menu here. And when you give it an ID, that ID is then used here in the callbacks to define which component that is. So that's your basic core component. The last piece are the HTML. So you'd have another thing in here called dash, I think HTML components, like that. Click over here, go back, and these dash very nicely has all of your standard HTML components, your headers, whatever you want, really. Anything you can think of. Headers, icons, links, whatever HTML component you're looking for. So with all that at your fingertips, it's really cool and really fast and easy to make an application. And I find it very satisfying that when I have an idea or when I want to share something with someone or even just do something for personal use, as you saw with those two applications, I can do it in not too much time, and they provide a really nice user guide, and the community is also very active. So I really appreciate Dash, and I hope that you try it, and stay tuned for the next series where we actually go and build something. I'm going to pull in a data set, have an idea for what I want to use. If you have an idea, go ahead and put it in the comments. I was thinking about doing something with air quality data, maybe something with CastNet. I like that data set. It's really cool, really high quality. It's like with ozone and temperature and humidity. We might play around with that. If you have a different suggestion or would like to see a specific kind of application, let me know in the comments. I'd be happy to try to explore that with you. In the meantime, stay tuned for the next one where we actually go and write a simple application. Thanks.